Greetings out there in YouTube land. It's John Field, and today's subject is award-winning costume designer and artist Theodora Van Runkle. Her credits are vast, and I will try and cover as much as I can. Her story begins on March 27, 1928, in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, where she was born Dorothy Schwepp, the product of an affair between Elsie Adair and Courtney Schwepp. Not long after her birth, Adair packed up her belongings and little Dorothy, then headed to California to make a fresh start. It was in Beverly Hills where Dorothy grew up and spent her childhood skating up and down the streets with her pet rat and drawing pictures on whatever paper she could find. As a little girl, she would attend the movies in the afternoon, and it was a screening of MGM's The Women that triggered her love of movies and introduced her to designer Adrian. When Dorothy was 16, she dropped out of school to marry Robert Van Runkle in 1944, and together they had two children, Max and Felicity Van Runkle. During her marriage, she began calling herself Theodora and perfecting her drawing and painting abilities while caring for her family. Robert and Theodora would later divorce, and she made a meager living working at I. Magnum's department stores as a fashion illustrator while supporting her two children. One day, she asked for a raise and was fired immediately. But for some reason, Theodora wasn't worried. A voice in her head told her she would be working in the movies. Now keep in mind, Theodora had no intention of ever being a part of the entertainment industry. She wanted to be an artist, and that was it. In 1965, there was a chance meeting with three-time Oscar-winning costume designer Dorothy Jenkins at a party, and they got acquainted. Jenkins was working on Hawaii at the time and needed a sketch artist and offered Theodora the job. For 1 month, Theodora cranked out sketches of the Regency era, and when the job came to an end, her reputation as an efficient sketch artist got out, and she was hired by Ray Aguillon to illustrate his Dr. Doolittle designs, and Renee Connolly for her Sand Pepins design. One fateful day, Theodora received a phone call from Jenkins saying that she had been offered to design a little Western over at Warner Brothers, and I recommended you. The little Western was Bonnie and Clyde. Theodora was happy and scared to be offered the job, but she had never designed costumes before and had no formal training in costume design. The only time she ever made clothes was for herself and her daughter using Vogue patterns. She also didn't know how to break down a script or continuity, so she was up against the elements. She met and interviewed with star and producer Warren Beatty and director Arthur Penn. They were charmed by the eccentric Van Runkle and presented her with a script, which she took home, read, and immediately began drawing the costumes. When Arthur Penn saw all the illustrations, he danced her around his office saying, "If the movie is as good as your drawings, we'll have a hit." The trio then hit a major snag. Theodora was not a member of the Costume Designers Guild, which meant she couldn't design the movie. Theodora, in desperation, grabbed Penn, telling him that this movie was going to make her career and she had to do it. Beatty was set on Theodora working on the movie and spent a few hours on the phone to Guild President Sheila O'Brien in a heated argument. A compromise was reached, and Theodora was finally allowed to work on the film. She began her search, scouring antique stores, vintage shops for fabrics, accessories, shoes, hats, etc. One day, while searching for buttons, Theodora had an encounter with Edith Head, and Head asked her what she was working on. Theodora replied that it was a 30s film about bank robbers, and Head said, "Do everything in chiffon and you'll have no problems." Needless to say, Theodora didn't follow Head's advice. While the clothes were being made at Warner Brothers, the table ladies couldn't believe that Theodora didn't want any padding or stiff interfacing in the dresses. Theodora chose vintage fabrics, thick, heavy wools for Clyde Barrow's suits, and soft silks for Bonnie Parker's skirts and dresses. Faye Dunaway was cast as Bonnie Parker, and Theodora couldn't have had a better star to dress. Originally, Dunaway wanted to wear slacks, but Theodora convinced her the look should be long skirts, loose blouses and sweaters, jackets, and of course, the famous beret. Now, if we look at the photos of the real Bonnie and Clyde, you can see that they look quite different from their glamorous counterparts. Here are a few photos recreating some of the infamous shots that the notorious couple took. Michael J. Pollard, Gene Hackman, and Estelle Parsons completed the main cast, and the filming proceeded in Texas and at Warner Brothers Studios on October the 4th, 1966 to January the 1st, 1967, and released August 13th, 1967. The film was not an immediate hit when first released. When Jack Warner saw the film, he hated it. Jack had this process of if he got up to go to the bathroom more than twice, then he wouldn't support it. Bonnie and Clyde was made like the films of the French New Wave, where the pacing was casual and the plot nonlinear, something that didn't sit well with Warner. You can safely guess that he went to the bathroom more than twice. In fact, he called Bonnie and Clyde, and I'm using correct terminology, a three-urinate picture. The film was distributed to second-run theaters and drive-ins, topping it off with all the major critics panning it, denouncing the film's violence. Pauline Kael came to the film's rescue by writing a 9,000-word rave review praising Bonnie and Clyde's artistic value in the New Yorker magazine. This review made the major film critics see the film again and reevaluate and realize what they had missed on the first viewing. The reviews were ecstatic, and because of this, Beatty appealed to Warner to release the film in more theaters, so Warner relented and released Bonnie and Clyde in first-run theaters. The film exploded, and audiences flocked to it, making it the second biggest hit at Warner Brothers. Jack Warner Brothers then said, "Now I like it." Bonnie and Clyde made Faye Dunaway a star. It put Theodora on the map, and her costume started a nostalgia trend. The young crowds began raiding their grandparents' attic for old clothes. Vintage shops couldn't keep up with the supply of vintage 30s clothes. Skirt lengths dropped and became the maxi. The beret became the only hat to wear. Theodora was told by many that ripping off her designs saved their business. She was now Hollywood's most in-demand costume designer. Around Oscar time, Bonnie and Clyde received 10 nominations, including one for Theodora, and she even designed Dunaway's Oscar gown of black silk trimmed with black roses. The film walked away with two Oscars, one for Estelle Parsons for Best Supporting Actress as Blanche Barrow, and for Burnett Guffey's cinematography. Unfortunately, Theodora lost the Oscar to John Truscott's extravagant designs in Camelot. Theodora and Dunaway would work together four more times in A Place for Lovers, The Arrangement, a theatrical production of A Streetcar Named Desire, and most of all, The Thomas Crown Affair. For The Thomas Crown Affair, Theodora created a series of stylish suits and mini-dresses that flipped to showcase Dunaway's gorgeous legs that would become her trademark. For headwear, Theodora put Dunaway's character Vicky in large hats, which was quite a change from the demure beret that had become famous. On one particular outfit in the film was a beige silk chiffon mini cocktail dress accessorized by a single brooch. The dress had a heavily gathered skirt and halter top that looked as if it were going to fall off. This dress became famous with the sex and chess scene between Dunaway and Steve McQueen. This film introduced Theodora to McQueen, and they would also go on to make two more films together. The King of Cool and Theodora joined forces on the film Bullet, where he donned turtleneck shirts and blazers. Theodora said in an interview that she dressed McQueen like her then-boyfriend, whom she was obsessed with. The boyfriend in question was Bruce McBroom, the well-known photographer whose most famous photo was the Farrah Fawcett poster of 1976. In 1968, saw the release of three Van Runkle films, and the third one was I Love You, Alice B. Toklas, a mediocre Peter Sellers comedy that's a Hollywood take on the hippie scene going on at the time. The film is very much a product of its time and hasn't aged very well, though Theodora's designs are worth checking out as research material. The Reavers was the third and final collaboration between McQueen and Theodora, and it was her first film set in turn of the century, where she dressed the cast in calico shirts, caps, pinstripe pants, suspenders, and other assorted menswear of that era. Her sketches look like portrait paintings of the La Belle Époque, with the large hair and the mono-bosom S-shaped silhouette of 1905. In 1970, Theodora would work on one of the most notorious films ever made, the big-screen version of Gore Vidal's Myra Breckinridge. Rex Reed played Myron, who gets a sex change and becomes Myra, played by Raquel Welch. The film received universally bad reviews, and the only good thing were Theodora's costumes. Here is the red, white, and blue ensemble that was used in the film's promotion. Here are two outfits seen in the film. Both have a 1940s look to them, a la Rosalind Russell in His Girl Friday mode. Mae West was also in the cast, and her costumes were designed by Edith Head. West had it written into her contract that only she could wear white in the film. When Welch got word of it, she wasn't too happy, so the next day of shooting, Welch came to the set wearing a black dress with light blue ruffles. In a Technicolor film, light blue always photographs white. Another version of the story is that Theodora had no idea about the clause in the contract, and she designed the dress anyway. Whatever is true, it does make an interesting story. Theodora designed Dalton Trumbo's film adaption of his novel, Johnny Got His Gun, and it was one of her favorite eras, the 1910s, with that sharp, tailored look in the suits and military uniforms. In 1973, Theodora designed this adorable flapper outfit worn by Pamela Franklin in Ace Eli and Roger of the Skies. It was on this film she first worked with Bernadette Peters, and they would make two more films together: The Jerk, which I'll discuss later, and Heartbeeps. That same year, Theodora also contributed costumes to Kid Blue, making her return to turn of the century, dressing stars Dennis Hopper in cowboy wear, Lee Purcell in assortment of lace-embroidered blouses, and Janice Rule dressed in elaborate items, complete with feathered hats like a peacock for her Lady of the Evening character. With the big screen adaptation of the hit Broadway musical Mame, Theodora went wild with her witty costumes set in the late 20s and early 30s. When Lucille Ball looked over the Theodora sketches, she looked at the designer and said, "They're good. Real good. Have my girls make them up over at CBS. They won't give you any lip." Despite having set up her wardrobe department at Warner Brothers Studios, Theodora complied. Bea Arthur returned to her Tony-winning role as Vera Charles, and Theodora remembered when she came into the fitting room saying, "I'm 30 pounds overweight, I'm gonna gain weight on this movie, and I'm not losing a pound for you." Though the film didn't receive the most stellar of reviews, Theodora did get good notices for her work. on and even won the American Millinery Institute's Golden Crown Award for all the outrageous hats featured in Maine. Now, I know for a fact that I am in the minority when I say I was not impressed with the costumes from The Godfather. There were a couple of interesting items, but the majority were just average. This is not the case with The Godfather Part 2. Theodora exceeded expectations with her participation in the production. One scene set in 1958 Reno, Nevada, the Corleone family are wanting to become WASPs and impress all the local Republicans. When director Francis Ford Coppola arrived to shoot the scene, he demanded to know why weren't the Corleone men in tuxedos. Theodora explained they would be too formal and what I stated early. Well, Coppola went off in a huff to his cabin and came out 15 minutes later and told Theodora, "Thought it over, and you're right." She dressed Al Pacino in a silver-gray mohair suit and Diane Keaton in silk lavender, and their characters' children, the boy in a little suit and the girl in a party dress. So they gave the illusion of an upper-middle-class family. Theodora deliberately put Fredo, played by the late, great John Cazal, in a plaid tuxedo with black pants and cummerbund, and wife Deanna in a peach strapless gown with white fur stole, so they would both stand out in a crowd dressed for church. Morgana King as Mama Corleone wears formal dress of plum silk chiffon with fur stole and brooch, making her look like the elegant matriarch of the Corleone family. Here she is joined by daughter Connie, played by Talia Shire, wearing a strapless aubergine cocktail dress with a dark green midriff accessorized with a bow, complete with black sable stole. The Corleone ladies loved furs. The dress Connie wears shows her descent into being the bad girl, which I wish the movie would have covered more of this, but the character only has 4 minutes of screen time. Diane Keaton's character, Kay, is trapped in the Corleone compound, not allowed to leave, and Theodora put Kay in a striped suit to symbolize prison clothes. One of Diane's most elegant outfits is the rose-pink houndstooth Chanel-like suit when she confronts Michael about his wrongdoings and informing him she got an abortion. The Godfather Part II brought Theodora back to her favorite era, the teens, and she dressed a young Vito Corleone, played by Robert De Niro, in working-class attire of shirts, vests, trousers, suspenders, caps, and an occasional jacket and coat. As Vito climbs the ladder of organized crime, his clothes become more classic. Believe it or not, every item of clothing in the film was custom made, and Theodora did extensive research on both periods of the teens and the late 50s. The Academy rewarded Theodora with her second Oscar nomination for her costumes, yet once again, she lost to Theoni V. Aldridge for her Great Gatsby creations. Nickelodeon was a movie about the early days of silent movies set in 1911, and Theodora venturing back to her preferred era of costuming with an all-star cast, with Peter Bogdanovich directing. The film was also another mediocre project where Theodora's design deserved to be in a better film. Nickelodeon pretty much came and went from theaters after being dismissed by critics and audiences. With New York, New York, Theodora worked on what was her most glamorous project since Maine. The film starred Liza Minnelli and Robert De Niro, reuniting after Godfather Part II, and directed by Martin Scorsese after his success with Taxi Driver. Set in post-war America, 1940s, De Niro played Jimmy Doyle, an ambitious musician, and Minnelli played singer Francine Evans. When watching the film, no one would ever know that it was made on a very low budget, and Theodora had to beg, borrow, and steal to put together the film's massive wardrobe. De Niro was decked out in sharp suits, and Minnelli in fashionable 40s frocks. One outfit that is a favorite of mine is the red dress trimmed with beads, sequins, and rhinestones, and I have to say, Minnelli never looked lovelier. At the time, Minnelli had some trouble with her weight, and a black beaded outfit that Theodora had made wouldn't fit her, and the title song of the movie was about to be shot in an hour. In desperation, Theodora jumped into the studio limo and headed to the nearest Halston boutique, where she purchased a large silk red blouse. Back at MGM Studios, Theodora threw the blouse on Minnelli and she looked fantastic. The scene was shot and became the highlight of the film. Theodora received a BAFTA nomination for her work, but lost to Danilo Donati for Fellini's Casanova. In 1978, saw Theodora design Ellen Burstyn's costumes for the film version of her Broadway hit that won her a Tony Award for Best Actress. Burstyn's character Doris went through many changes from simple 50s housewife, sophisticated lady, a hippie, and finally a businesswoman. The black cocktail dress was originally envisioned in red, but the director vetoed Theodora's vision and wanted black. So, black it was. My only problem with Same Time Next Year was the cinematography, because I think Robert Surtees overdid it with the Vaseline on the camera lens shooting in what I like to call glaucoma vision. In Heaven Can Wait, Theodora reunited with Warren Beatty and contributed costumes for Diane Cannon and Julie Christie, while Richard Bruno dressed the rest of the cast. Both films were box office hits, and which was nice for Theodora after designing two flops. After researching Theodora's films, I feel she was at her best when she did comedy. And with The Jerk, she sparkled. The Jerk starred Steve Martin as Navin Johnson, a dim-witted but lovable character who wanted to be somebody. Navin was born a poor black child of Mississippi sharecroppers. Theodora dressed the Johnson family in 1930s Depression era with the men in faded overalls and plaid work shirts, complete with straw hats. The ladies wore faded calico and gingham prints with aprons, shawls, and cardigan sweaters. Navin realizes he must go out into the world, and he wears this very bizarre traveling outfit with an aviator's cap with goggles and leather jacket. He gets a job at a gas station and wears a white uniform that was common in the 1950s, complete with cap and bow tie. Later in the film, Navin becomes a carnival barker, and his wacky uniform consisting of checkerboard pants, top hat, and exaggerated tuxedo jacket. It is also in this scene where he meets his first love interest, or lust interest would be more appropriate, in Patty Bernstein, the carnival stunt rider. Patty, played by Catlin Adams, is the prototype bad girl of the piece. Dressed in a studded leather jacket, bustier, and leather pants, her short magenta-colored hair is very punk rock, which was in full swing at the time. Her red costume personifies her image as a sexy badass. However, she is no match for Marie, played by Bernadette Peters. Marie looks like a 1930s heroine with Peter Pan collars and cuffs. She is all sexy innocence in this midriff, and in this cute little number, perfect for Studio 54, while emphasized by her Cupid doll beauty. Navin becomes wealthy by inventing the OptiGrab, and because of this newfound wealth, his wardrobe becomes more outlandish, very common with the nouveau riche. Here, He is all pimped out in a leisure jacket, lime green shirt, white satin scarf, and a fedora with a skinny long feather topped off with shades. In the other picture, Naven wears a gaudy brocade jacket with velvet lapels accessorized with a lot of gold chains. However, Naven loses his fortune after the OptiGrab turns out to be defective, and he is reduced to this while wailing,
"I don't need anything but this remote control, this chair, this paddle ball, this lamp, these matches, and this magazine."
Not to worry, folks. It all ends happy with the Johnson family investing the money Naven sent them, making them all very wealthy. They find Naven, and he goes back to Marie and his family. Theodora's next comedy was the Hollywood satire SOB, and Julie Andrews played Sally Miles, a thinly disguised version of herself. The film within the film, called Nightwind, flops at the box office, and Sally's director husband decides to reshoot a fantasy sequence and make it X-rated, where America's sweetheart goes topless. Theodora clearly had a lot of fun on this one, coming up with one outrageous outfit after another. The opening credits are all G-rated with colorful images of butterflies, fairies, clowns, and other wholesome assortments. Shelley Winters plays a version of the super agent Sue Mingers in Kaftans and this fur ensemble. Marissa Berenson wears a metallic jumpsuit that Theodora decided it needed to be dangerously low cut. While in the fitting room, Theodora took some scissors and cut the cleavage even lower and had her seamstress hem it up. The results were stunning and it added to Berenson's vamp character. For the scene where Sally bears all, Theodora saw a Richard Avedon photo and said, "That's the dress," and had it made up in red chiffon. Here is the actual photo, and next to it is Julie in the outfit. And no, I am not posting a topless photo of Julie. You'll have to rent the movie if you want to see that. The best little whorehouse in Texas was the Broadway smash that was turned into a film by writer-director Colin Higgins, who penned Harold and Maude and 9 to 5. When Higgins met Theodora, it was kismet. "Colin just got me," said Theodora, and the two developed a successful working relationship. Theodora showed Higgins a design for Miss Mona, played by Dolly Parton, that she dubbed Miss Mona Aflame with Passion, and said this was going to cost extra. Higgins looked at her dead in the eye and said, "Make it." The result was this sparkling gown made of red, orange, and blue bugle beads and silk organza. The Aphrodite gown was another memorable piece of black velvet embroidered with crystal and silver beads to look like exploding semen. Theodora also designed a wide assortment of lingerie and over-the-top items, making this one of the most visually fun in her filmography. The collaboration between Theodora and Dolly was so successful, they reteamed one more time on Rhinestone, where Dolly attempts to make a country singer out of Sylvester Stallone. Here is an interesting bit of trivia about the character Melvin P. Thorpe. He was based on reporter the late Marvin Zindler of Houston, Texas, who was the one that broke the chicken ranch story that occurred in Fayette County in Texas near LaGrange. In 1983, Theodora worked on a short-lived medieval fantasy series on CBS called Wizards and Warriors, and this show brought our Theodora a well-deserved Emmy Award for Best Costume Design in a Series. After two Oscar nominations and a BAFTA nod, she finally won an industry trophy. Here are Theodora's costume designs for the series, and they look like they could be from a book of illustrations. the budget was not very big and the final product didn't look exactly like the sketches, but they were imaginative and flamboyant to merit acclaim for Theodora. Peggy Sue Got Married was a reunion for Theodora and Francis Ford Coppola 10 years after working on The Godfather Part II. Kathleen Turner played the title character, and after collapsing at her high school reunion, finds herself back in 1960. Here, she is wearing the most well-known dress in the film, a silver lamé formal with gathered neckline and a full mop skirt with silver belt. This was Peggy Sue's prom dress, and she can still fit into it. When transported back in time, she is wearing the same dress, only it is now a soft blue-gray. Watching the film, I noticed the school colors are ice gray and lemon yellow, and the color palette is very sedate with soft pastels, pale natural brown, tan, light green, beige, and light blue. And my interpretation is that the film avoided bold colors to fit in with the dreamlike nature of the film. Here is Peggy Sue with the Richard Norvik character, and she is wearing gray plaid pedal pushers and sweater as they plot a money-making scheme. And in the next photo, she is making a pair of pantyhose, which did not exist in 1960. Here is Peggy Sue with her friends watching her future husband Charlie, played by Nicolas Cage, and his music group perform Don't Know Why I Love You. The girls are all in soft colors and the men wear gold lamé jackets, the only other strong color in the film. In the finale, where Peggy Sue's grandfather's lodge attempts to send her back to 1985, it is here where gold and purple are used and they stand out amongst a sea of natural colors. Theodora received her third and final Oscar nomination but lost to Jenny Bevan and John Bright for their Edwardian designs in A Room with a View. For Everybody's All-American, Theodora dressed the lovely Jessica Lange in charming 50s gowns like this pink ensemble that, according to the sketch, was originally violet. I think they made the right choice going with pink. Here, Jessica wears this charming little yellow outfit from 1956 and this lavish wedding gown. I also want to show the football uniforms worn in the film by Dennis Quaid and John Goodman. After working on Everybody's All-American, she designed the film Wildfire, but that was another film that did nothing for anyone's career and it came and went with no fanfare. However, Theodora rebounded with another comedy, the cult classic Troop Beverly Hills. At the time of release, it received poor reviews, most notably by Siskel and Ebert, and flopped at the box office. Thanks to home video and television airings, the film began to build an audience of girls both young and old. Theaters around the country, particularly the Alamo Draft House, have screenings complete with costume contests and quote-alongs. Theodora went wild in creating the over-the-top costumes. In fact, she got her first on-screen mention in one scene where Shelley Long's Phyllis character is asked by the divorce court judge what she is wearing. Van Ronkle, isn't it fabulous? As Phyllis, a wealthy Beverly Hills socialite, becomes her daughter's Girl Scout troop's den mother, and she isn't happy with the uniform she is required to wear. So she goes to her tailor and he makes some serious modifications, resulting in a broad-shouldered power uniform. Here, Phyllis wears a lavender nightgown and peignoir trimmed with lavender fur as she and the girls camp out at the Beverly Hills Hotel. And personally, I can't think of a better place to camp. Here is a sketch of the red and black suit accessorized with the beaded bird on the shoulder and the executed design worn by Phyllis. And let's not leave out Craig T. Nelson's suit that epitomizes the Miami Vice style, very popular in the 1980s. My favorite getup in the movie is this evening gown of pink, mint green, periwinkle blue, and light purple. And the best way to describe it is sherbet ice cream. This is how I love to remember 80s formal wear, with the big billowy skirts that take on a life of their own. The gown now resides at the Western Costume Company, if it hasn't been sold already. Here are three more items. The gown is missing a bead, combining khaki and gold lamé, as well as being introduced by Robin Leach. And finally, this can only be described as marzipan picnic shelter. Shelley Long paid a wonderful compliment to Theodora, saying, "When I put the dress on, I knew who Phyllis was, and that was perfect. And that has never happened to me before, where a costumer showed me who my character was." I can't leave out Phyllis's best friend, Vicky Spratz, played by Stephanie Beecham, a romance novelist clearly based on Jackie Collins. She is dressed in leopard prints and various leathers, giving a nice contrast to Phyllis's more ultra-feminine attire. As the 90s came to pass, Theodora's film work began to slow down, but she still managed to produce memorable works such as Stella, with Bette Midler, a remake of the Barbara Stanwyck classic Stella Dallas, and 1991 saw the release of The Butcher's Wife, starring Demi Moore as Southern clairvoyant Marina Lemke, who changes the lives of the people in her Manhattan neighborhood for the better. Here is Marina working in her husband's shop, wearing a dress that seems to be from another time, like the mid-30s. And my interpretation is that she makes her own clothes from her grandmother's old patterns. I have to include this gay character played by Thomas Michael Ford, and he is just too adorable to ignore, dressed in red and gold, the very personification of fabulous. Here are a few concept illustrations for Marina showing an eccentric style for a Southern clairvoyant. Finally, Mary Steenburgen as Stella Kiefover goes from plain and dowdy to glamorous in this periwinkle dress embroidered with sequins and silk flowers, singing the blues as her shy character comes out of her shell. Steve Martin and Theodora reteamed for Leap of Faith, where Martin played Jonas Nightingale, a phony evangelist, and Theodora dressed him in the now famous mirror jacket. The waitress uniform worn by Lolita Davidovich is classic Van Runkle with the collar and cuffs, checked print and apron. Between 1993 and 1994 saw no films by Theodora until 1995 with Kiss of Death starring David Caruso and Nicolas Cage. This was a very gritty crime drama and a loose remake of the 1947 classic. The designs were not showy, but realistic and intimidating. Other films that followed Kiss of Death were a sci-fi epic called White Dwarf that aired on Fox, The Last Dawn, a miniseries based on Mario Puzo's novel that aired on CBS, and the independent film I'm Losing You. In 1998, Patricia Arquette got Van Runkled in the film Goodbye Lover. Now, I never cared for late 90s fashions because I find them drab, but here Theodora manages to liven them up with this black and white print dress and these sleek items that bring back memories of the wet look from the 1980s. The 1999 Showtime remake of Jason Miller's Tony and Pulitzer Prize-winning play, That Championship Season, was to be Theodora's final film. The story was about four men and their coach reuniting 20 years after their victory in the Pennsylvania State Championship game, where deep secrets are unearthed. After production wrap, Theodora retired from the entertainment industry and spent a lot of her time at her beautiful cottage in Laurel Canyon, where she would garden and here is where she would draw and paint. Here's where she would entertain guests and occasionally conduct interviews discussing films she had worked on. In 2002, the Costume Designers Guild honored Theodora with a Career Achievement Award that she knocked everyone dead in this red and black lace number. Her Guild Award sat right next to her Emmy in her workroom. Here are some samples of her paintings she did in her final years. Watercolor and gouache were the mediums Theodora liked working in, and looking at her work, it was so vibrant and full of life. She also loved cats, and they were featured quite a bit in her artwork, and she called them the Kit Cats. Those that knew Theodora said she was a genuine, one-of-a-kind eccentric who was kind and charming, and as the title of this video says, everyone's Auntie Mame. Years ago, I did this illustration of Theodora and her famous costumes. I wanted to send it to her, but had no idea where to send it. One of these days, I hope to give it to her children. On November 4th, 2011, Theodora passed away from lung cancer at age 83 and left behind a legacy of beautiful designs and artwork and several classic films to be enjoyed by all. Thank you for watching, and I hope you enjoyed this video about this unique lady's life and career. Please like and subscribe, and that is the way the cow ate the cabbage.